Last time we were on transferases. We have already done transferases. Today we will talk about hydrolysis. So let's see. This hydrolysis, the name, as name suggests, what is hydrolysis? It actually breaks the bond by using water molecule, H2O molecule. The bond can be carbon-oxygen bond can be carbon-nitrogen bond can be carbon-carbon bond. So this H2O, utilizing this H2O, the bond between the covalent bond is broken down. This is called hydrolysis. And what are the examples of hydrolysis? All digestive enzymes. All digestive enzymes. Wherever you see digestion, whether it is intracellular digestion or extracellular digestion. So extracellular digestion is digestion that happens inside intestine, that you see in intestine. Digestion of protein, carbohydrate, lipid. This all digestion is done by hydrolysis. And the intracellular digestion that happens in lysosome. So digestion inside lysosome will also happen through hydrolysis. So lysosomal enzymes are also hydrolysis. Now you can see these are the example, few important examples of hydrolysis. You can see trypsin, chymotrypsin, amylase. These are enzymes of digestion that take part in digestion. Now acid phosphatase and alkaline phosphatase. These are related to bone remodeling. These enzymes are related to bone remodeling. And these enzymes are also what? Hydrolysis. So you can see all hydrolysis are given three number. You can see here. So this phosphate, ALP, alkaline phosphate, phosphatase is a reversible reaction. It will add phosphate or remove phosphate to organic compound. So this is organic compound. It is removing phosphate from organic compound at pH of at alkaline pH. And it begins with 3. So you can see this enzyme also. Acetylcholine acetyl transfer is very important enzyme. This enzyme is very important. It will be required for breakdown of acetylcholine at synapse. So acetylcholine esterase is also, it breaks, remove acetyl group from this choline. This is called choline. So breaks acetylcholine using water. So this is acetylcholine esterase and present in the third group. So this is, these are all hydrolysis. Now let's talk about lyases. So lyases means breaks. It breaks the bond. Lies the bond. It breaks the bond. Okay? Breaks the bond. Now you can see this. Lyases will break the bond between carbon-carbon, carbon-oxygen and carbon-nitrogen, as you can see here. And the systemic name is formed according to substrate group lyase. So this is the lyase. You can see one of the lyase. You can see echotinase. Why I have taken example, you can see the water is being added here. So in that sense, you would understand this should be a hydrolysis, but this is not a hydrolysis. Remember, one very difference between, this is a hydrolyase, okay? This is a hydrolyase. The difference between hydrolysis and hydrolyase is, this hydrolysis breaks covalent bond, sigma bond. It breaks sigma bond, single covalent bond. Sigma bond means single covalent bond. Single covalent bond. But if you can see for hydrolyase here, it breaks the double bond, the pi bond. Pi bond. When water is utilized to break this pi bond, you have to call it a lyase. A lyase. It is not a hydrolyse. This is the big difference between hydrolyase and lyase. Okay? When double bond is broken through water, by utilizing water, it is a lyase. But when single bond is broken down using water, it is called hydrolysis. So this is a big difference. So confusion will happen here only. Otherwise, you will not have confusion. A second very important enzyme you will see in glycolysis is aldolase. Aldolase is a lyase. You will see this enzyme. We will talk about this enzyme in glycolysis. Glycolysis. Okay? So remember this double bond break, when water is utilized to break the double bond, it is lyase, it is not hydrolase. So citrate, this aconitase, we will study aconitase in citric acid cycle. This is a lyase. Now let's talk about isomerase. So this is very easy to understand. Isomerase are any enzyme that will actually change one enzyme in one compound into another compound. For example, glucose 6 phosphate is changed into fructose 6 phosphate. Glucose and fructose both are 6 carbon compound, both are carbohydrate. But what is there? Glucose and fructose are isomer to each other. So enzyme that convert this glucose 6 phosphate into fructose 6 phosphate is an isomerase. So we will study about this enzyme in glycolysis. This is glucose 6 phosphate, G6 phosphate. Simply you write the name of this substrate and enzyme, isomerase. Put the name isomerase. So this is very easy to understand the enzyme. If you understand the enzyme and reaction, you will easily understand the pathway. So these are the different names of this isomerases. It can be racemases when it can change the optical isomerism. It can be epimerase. It can be cis trans isomerase. It can be called isomerases, tautomerases, and mutases and cycloases. These are the different names of the group of enzyme called isomerase. So we will find mutases at different places in glycolysis only. Okay, we will find mutases. Which mutases? We will find 1, 3. Actually, we will find a mutase. Which mutase? 1,3 bisphosphate mutase, and that is actually the enzyme present in RBC. 1,3 BPG mutase. So this is very important enzyme. It is present in RBC. So mutase and phosphofructomutase. So one other mutases we will study in glycolysis. So remember for the time being this enzyme. Okay, mutase. One mutase is there. 2,3 phosphoglycerate mutase. So this 2 glycerate mutase here also phosphoglycerate mutase. So we will study about this mutase in glycolysis. So remember this 2 mutase. Now you can see isomerase. So this is isomerase. I have already told you conversion of glucose 6 phosphate into, and this may starts with number 5. Isomerase start with number 5. Now let's talk about ligase. So ligases are enzyme catalyzing the joining. So it join two things together. So it is ligase. And then two molecules coupled with hydrolysis of diphosphate. Always and always remember. So when there is first condition for ligase is formation of bond. First condition, formation of bone. And this is not the only one condition. Second condition is utilization of ATP. If you can see, if formation of bone only happens, but there is no utilization of ATP, no utilization of energy, that means it is not a ligase. Okay. So formation of bond, covalent bond, by utilization of energy from ATP. So these two conditions are there for ligases. So what happens is for aldolase, you see aldolase reaction happens. So fructose 1,6 bisphosphate will be changed into dihydroxyacetone phosphate plus 3-phosphoglyceraldehyde. So 3-phosphoglyceraldehyde dihydroxyacetone phosphate will be formed from this fructose 1,6 bisphosphate. This is actually a lyase. So breaking of bond will happen. So actually, hexose sugar, this sugar actually will break into two groups like this. So this type of compound it will break. But what will happen? This is a reversible enzyme and it will not utilize ATP. So if you see an opposite reaction, so it seems this reaction seems to be a ligase reaction. But this aldolase does not utilize ATP. Does not utilize ATP. And that is why if does not utilize ATP, we don't call it ligase. We call it ligase. It breaks the bone. So that is why aldolase is placed into ligase, not into ligase, because aldolase does not utilize ATP. Remember this very important difference between ligase and ligase. So here you can see the difference between ligase. Ligase always utilize ATP, but ligase never utilize ATP. That is a big difference. Sometimes in reversible reaction, ligase may look like ligase if you see opposite reaction, but ligase always utilize ATP, whereas ligase never utilize ATP. Very big difference. Now let's see the example. So this type of example, this reaction of ligase, you will see during protein synthesis. So this is very important enzyme. So amino acyl, tyrosine is amino acid. So there are 20 amino acyl tRNA synthase. Now see, this tyrosine tRNA means amino acyl tRNA synthesis. This enzyme actually synthesize, utilize ATP and synthesize this tyrosine and tRNA. It will join tyrosine and tRNA together to form L-tyrosyl tRNA. And this type of enzyme catalyze all the reaction. This is the first step, the rate limiting step of protein synthesis. Very, very important. Rate limiting step of protein synthesis. This reaction will be utilized. It will be helpful for when you study translation in genetics. I'm teaching you a part of genetics here. Rate limiting step of translation. Remember this. Now let's see. I'll talk about second very important reaction. Now you see this carbon dioxide addition. Here we have seen the amino acid addition to tRNA. Now we will see here carbon dioxide addition to molecules. And the carbon dioxide addition to molecule is done by the enzyme called carboxylases. Okay, this group of enzyme. There are only 4 carboxylases in our body. Oh, we will talk about those 4 carboxylases. And those all 4 carboxylases are very important. And these carboxylases utilize biotin. Vitamin biotin to add carbon dioxide in addition to ATP, because it is a ligase. That is why it will utilize ATP. In addition to utilizing ATP, it will utilize what? Biotin. And utilizing biotin, it will, you can see this molecule, 1, 2, 3 carbon. With this 3 carbon, 1, 2, 3 carbon, third carbon, you can see addition of COO group, carboxy group. Addition of carbon dioxide as carboxy group by utilizing ATP. This enzyme are called carboxylase. This is one of the important enzyme. Here is the example of pyruvate carboxylase. So remember this pyruvate carboxylase always. Pyruvate carboxylase. And you can see the number given, 6 number is given to this pyruvate carboxylase. So these are the very important, 2 important example of ligases. Now, just I want you to remember this carboxylase so that I'm giving you a trick to remember. You can see how I have depicted this ATP. So ATP, I told you, just remember this phosphate like this, pentose. And with one of the thumb, phosphates are attached with one of the thumbs. What? Adenine is attached. This is ATP. Now what happens with this ATP? So this is a carboxylase. Pyruvate carboxylase is a ligase. It will utilize phosphate ATP. Now remember, this carbon dioxide is an insect, like insect. And you can see here biotin. You can see biotin. Biotin is like this. And with one beak, to this beak, what is there? To this beak, it will utilize it. It will catch this carbon dioxide and add to this pyruvate, and pyruvate is formed. So I have also made it easy to remember pyruvate, P and V. So with V, one oxygen is attached like P. So this is pyruvate, and COOH group is there at one terminal. This is pyruvate. So understanding the structure of pyruvate will be necessary. Now addition of this carboxy group to this will form oxaloacetate. So conversion of pyruvate into oxaloacetate is very, very important reaction. Remember this reaction. This is called anaplerotic reaction. Just I will not tell you right now what is the meaning of anaplerotic reaction. Just remember the term. We will talk about anaplerotic reaction. You search this reaction yourself. Anaplerotic reaction. So this is very, very important reaction. The conversion of, you can see the biotin is utilized. This is biotin. Biotin, you can see the biotin is like B here. Biotin is like B. So biotin is utilized to transfer carbon dioxide to some molecule by utilizing ATP. That is why all carboxylases are ligases. Remember, all carboxylases plus this amino acyl tRNA synthetase. tRNA synthetase. There are 20 specific type of amino acyl tRNA synthetase. So this way you have already studied about 14 enzymes. 14 enzymes, very important enzymes of the body. If you understand this carboxylase and this amino acyl tRNA synthesis. So this is all about enzyme classification. So enzyme classification is very, very, very important to understand pathway also, biochemistry also. So see, we will be using this summary. So this is enzyme. So enzyme, I have given you three. So don't lose the track. I have already talked about 1S. Is cell 1S is what we have already talked about, active site A part. So active site, what is there in active site? We have done this, vitamins, minerals, and side chains. And then we have already done with this classification. Specificity means classification, which type of reaction will catalyze. So these are the important part of classification. If you can see at the bottom, so group one, oxidoreductase, the important part is cytochrome 450. It causes hydroxylation. And second important reaction is cytochrome oxidase. So, and many dehydrogenases are there. So these reactions are very important. All important thing I have placed in one slide so that you will understand all important thing. So we have done active site, we have done this. Now we will talk about this reaction condition. So after this we will talk about this simple graph. So it is very easy to understand. We will go a bit faster in this. So go through this, okay? Go through this yourself. This is actually slide from first aid USMLE. Now just answer this question, which of the following enzymes always require coenzyme for their action? Always require coenzyme? Fast, be fast.
D.
D require ATP. If ATP is not a coenzyme, no problem. ATP is energy currency. We don't take it as enzyme. It is energy. Anyway, at least you notice that. Good.
So A.
A is the answer. Oxidoreductase will always utilize. Okay? Always utilize coenzyme. So wherever you see oxidoreductase, so remember that it will always utilize coenzyme. No oxidoreductase act without enzyme. This is a universal fact. So oxidoreductase always utilize enzyme. 95% of transferase utilize coenzyme. Other may or may not utilize enzyme. So this is oxidoreductase 100% will utilize coenzyme. Remember, this is very important. Which are the following group of enzymes involved in production of ATP for survival? So which will produce ATP? Which enzyme? Substrate level phosphorylation or okay. Which actually group will produce ATP?
A.
A. Yes. A. Cytochrome oxidase. Got this? Cytochrome oxidase. It is called cytochrome oxidase and actually electron transport chain enzymes. So this all electron transport chain behave as enzyme. They are very responsible for production of ATP. Okay. And second, you will see I have not given the example substrate level phosphorylation. There is something called substrate level phosphorylation. And this substrate level of phosphorylation is done by kinase. Remember this. We will talk about substrate level phosphorylation in glycolysis. This is done by kinase, because kinase either remove phosphate from ATP or add phosphate to ADP and convert into ATP. So we will talk about that. Which of the following enzymes are involved in digestion of food and in intestine?
Hydrolysis.
Yes, hydrolysis. Right. Now kinases fall in group of the following group. Which group? Kinase.
Transferase.
Yes. Right. Now, what is the role of enzyme named with kinase? You know it. Okay. It either transfer phosphate to substrate from ATP or from phosphate. It can also transfer phosphate to ADP and convert ADP into ATP. So two-way reaction. Kinases can be two-way reaction. What is the role of enzyme named with phosphorylation?
Transfer of phosphate groups.
Transfer phosphate group. Actually, it is a transferase. It breaks the bond using phosphate. It breaks the bond using phosphate. It breaks the bond using phosphate. Can you imagine? Can you? Do you remember this picture? Okay, it utilizes phosphate to break the bond. It is a transferase. Okay, most of the carboxylase in body are part of which of the following group? Which of the following group?
E.
It's
E.
Yes, E. Now, which of the following in group of enzymes you always utilize ATP?
G.
Ligase. Yes, ligase always. So carboxylases utilize which of the following vitamin as coenzyme?
Biotin.
Yes, biotin. Yeah. Now let's talk about factors affecting enzymes. So factors affecting enzyme. When we talk about factors affecting enzymes, we can classify broadly into one into enzyme related factors. Enzyme related factors. So enzyme related factors, we will talk about this enzyme related factors in kinetics also. Okay, kinetics actually we will understand in more detail. So here we will talk, so it will also help you understand kinetics. Okay, now temperature and pH. You see, this temperature and pH, it is environment related. Environment related. So which would be the more important in this two section? This is more important, okay? This is more important because I will ask question from this in kinetics. So I will go very fast with this, and these are also very easy. So you will have easy. So five factors are there. One is okay, enzyme related factor, enzymes, and the enzyme act on substrate, and enzyme has coenzyme. So these are all enzyme related factor, enzyme, substrate, and coenzyme. And there are two, temperature and pH. So temperature and pH, we will focus more on temperature and figure, temperature and pH. I will also ask question from temperature and pH related to this. Okay, just understand this. So if you increase the enzyme concentration, okay, so what will happen? Rate of reaction will increase. That is simple to understand. It's not that difficult. So that is why enzyme and rate of reaction has direct proportional. It is straight line curve. So just remember this curve. It is very easy. Enzyme, how enzyme affect the rate of reaction? You increase the enzyme concentration. As much you increase the enzyme concentration, the rate of reaction will increase proportionately. Now let's talk about the substrate concentration. When you add substrate, so what will happen? The rate of reaction will, so there is 10 enzymes are there. Suppose when you add that substrate, and then if you add the substrate about 10, there is 10 substrate. So what will happen after 10 substrate, this all 10 substrate will bind to 10 enzymes. After that, even you add substrate, there will not be significant increase in rate of reaction because all enzymes are occupied. That is why initially there will be proportional, and then stagnation you will see. So this type of curve is called hyperbolic curve. Okay, so substrate concentration, how does substrate concentration affect the reaction? So this is how the curve, you will get a hyperbolic curve in such condition. So we will talk about this hyperbolic curve, don't worry. So substrate will influence, this is how substrate will influence the reaction. Now coenzyme, so coenzymes will have different approach. So if coenzyme is integral part, so it is, if it is integral part, so it will help, it will behave like enzyme, okay? If it is not integral part, like NADH, so when it is a part of solution, not tightly bound, it is part, it is a coenzyme, loosely bound coenzyme. When it is a prosthetic group, it performs like enzyme. So path, the curve will be straight line. But when it is like substrate, it is like, it is loosely bound. So it will have curve like this. Okay? So this is two curve you will see in coenzyme effect. Now let's talk about more important thing. So in temperature, and both in pH, you will get a bell shape. In temperature also, in pH also, you will see a bell-shaped curve. So this is very easy to understand. So what will happen? So when you increase a temperature or pH, so at an optimal temperature also pH, so reaction rate will be highest. But when you decrease temperature or pH, reaction rate decreases. Again, if you increase the temperature or pH, reaction rate will again decrease. So this is a bell-shaped curve. So for both temperature and pH, how does temperature affect reaction? How does temperature and pH affect reaction? So there is optimal temperature and pH where rate of reaction is highest. But when you decrease either temperature or pH or increase temperature or pressure, what will happen? Reaction rate will decrease in either way. Got this? So this is how you will get, remember the graph only. If you remember two, okay, straight line graph, you will see, remember this hyperbolic graph, and if you remember bell-shaped graph, you will remember everything. So temperature is bell-shaped graph. And see, very important thing about temperature, generally optimum temperature in our body is body temperature. We know this, body temperature is 37 degrees Celsius. And this is the optimum temperature, 37. And very important fact about this, Q10, a concept of Q10 is very important. I'll give you one example. During summer time, if you put the food outside, during summer time, what will happen? Food will be spoiled very fast. But during winter time, what will happen? Food will not be spoiled that soon. So why does it happen? Because during summer time, the temperature is high. So high temperature will correlate with higher activity of enzyme, higher enzyme activity. When temperature is low, what will happen? So activity of enzyme will become low. And this is, how does this happen? With each 10 degree, if you increase each 10 degree Celsius, what will happen? Reaction rate will double, velocity will double. You can see here. So this is like T1 temperature. Now this is V1, but if you increase 10 degrees Celsius, here T plus 10, so what will happen is reaction rate will double here. Reaction rate will double like this. So this will be 2V. You understood? Up to optimal pH. Up to optimal pH. If you go down to the optimal pH, if you go beyond the optimal pH, the, again, what will happen? The temperature, actually velocity will decrease the same fashion. Double decrease will be, double dip will happen with each 10 degrees Celsius. So this rule is called rule of Q10. With rise in 10 degrees Celsius, there will be doubling of reaction. This is called rule of Q10. This means what? Velocity is doubled when temperature rises. This is one of the important thing about temperature, not about pH. This is important thing about Q10 is very important about temperature. So you can see this, why does this change in pH? So reason why pH change causes change in activity is because this. So enzyme has many side chain. This enzyme has side chain at active site, and actually side chain everywhere. So if you change the pH, what will happen? The structure of enzyme as well as active site of enzyme will change. The electrical charge will change in active site as well as whole enzyme. If electrical charge change with pH, what will happen? Enzyme activity will also change. At optimal pH, the electrical charge will be optimal. But when you decrease the pH or increase the pH, what will happen is, so the charge will be altered. And that is why, even if you decrease the temperature or increase the temperature, the result will be decrease in enzyme activity. And this is why there will be a bell-shaped curve. So remember, this bell-shaped curve is applicable both for temperature and pH. That is how it is very easy to remember factors affecting enzyme. There are five factors. Three are related to enzymes, two are related to environment. These three factors are enzyme. Second factor is coenzyme. Third factor is substrate. So, and this environment related factors are temperature and pressure. And this environment related factor are more important. Both temperature and pressure has bell-shaped curve. In both cases, there is concept of optimum pH, optimum temperature, and temperature is related to Q10 rule, and this pH is related to electrical charge concept. Okay, remember this, these are very important things. Now we will actually talk about question. So the coenzyme which requirement increases with increase in protein intake plays a key role in glycogenolysis and loss of memory confusion are related to deficient condition. Related in deficient condition. So which coenzyme actually is related to this? When you increase the protein intake, what will happen? The coenzyme will increase. So you don't know this, just remember this. This is a theory also. So the PLP. So PLP, vitamin B6, is central to protein catabolism. It is central because we will require this very much. That is why I have written here. Central to protein catabolism. Protein catabolism. And this is important part of transamination reaction. I can ask this question. Transamination reaction. Amination reaction. Vitamin B6 is very important for transamination reaction. That is a transferase type of reaction. Okay? So that is why I have written. So these are the presentation in vitamin B6 deficiency. Loss of memory will be there. And this enzyme is very important also for glycogenolysis. This is also part of one enzyme called glycogen phosphorylase. Glycogen phosphorylase that I told you, phosphorylase. So these two enzymes contain vitamin B6 in this enzyme classification I have already talked about. Two enzymes. So remember, this is vitamin B6 is very important. I can ask question from vitamin B6. Now, a person having delayed wound healing might have deficiency of which of the following cofactor?
Zinc.
What?
Zinc.
What?
Zinc.
Yes, you're right. You're right. Good. Why? Because zinc is part of DNA and RNA polymerase. It is a prosthetic group here. It is a tightly bound. It is a prosthetic group. Okay, so remember this fact because it will also help you understand genetics. So zinc, I have given only, I have taken one example of one mineral here, zinc. And iron is involved in oxidoreductase. You will see iron involved in oxidoreductase. So I am taking here example of zinc only. So we will talk about iron taking part in oxidoreductase reaction, minerals. These minerals, wherever we will talk about these minerals when we talk about actually pathway. At places we will talk about minerals and vitamins. So you will have to make a collective note of those minerals and vitamins together. Because minerals and vitamins are important part of USMLE or any exam in this world. Whatever you talk about nutrition, because it is also becomes very important about yourself, your understanding also. If you know about the nutrition, you will understand, you will be a good doctor. You will prescribe a good nutrition to the to your patient. So person cannot tolerate pH drop below 6.0 8. Why? Patient can die.
B
enzyme activity, yes. With decrease in pH, enzyme activity will be low. And if enzyme activity is low, patient cannot survive. Person cannot survive. Now we have done reaction condition. You can see the graph. So you memorize this graph. If you memorize this graph, so put everything into imagination, this whole picture into imagination. Use this. This is a brain map, memory technique. This is a memory technique. I am giving us summary in the form of memory technique. So you can use this mnemonics, 3S, RN. You can memorize everything about vitamin. Anywhere you sit, just close your eyes and you can recall everything through this chart. Now we have already done this. We have already done this. And then we have already done this three part. We will be talking about this speed of reaction and this selectivity. So speed of reaction. So these are the graph you can see about the speed of reaction. So kinetics, we will talk about kinetics. Kinetics means speed. That's simple. It is simple because it means speed. So enzyme kinetics deals with the speed of reaction. That's easy. So how does the speed of reaction is increased by enzyme? We have already told you it is by decreasing activation energy. Okay, by decreasing activation energy. But actually what happens? Enzyme chooses a different pathway having low activation energy. Okay, real concept is that enzyme chooses a different pathway having low activation energy. How does it decrease activation energy? So this decreases activation energy by choosing a different pathway. So enzyme chooses a different pathway. So this is the main pathway, you can see. This is highest activation energy. And this is how enzyme increases the rate of reaction. This is how enzyme decreases the rate of reaction. Enzyme choose a alternative pathway of reaction having lower activation energy. You can see this. So this is enzyme, pathway of enzyme. You can see this is pathway of enzyme. This is the main pathway. And you can see the enzyme choosing a different pathway, having low activation energy. And this is how enzyme increases the rate of reaction. Okay, this is free energy of reaction. This is the rate of reaction. And this is how after increasing, this is a substrate and this is product. Now let's see enzymes, formation of enzyme substrate complex. So it is based on what? Selectivity. Why enzyme is very selective? I told you selectivity. So in 3S, this is 1S. So why enzyme is very selective? So this actually will answer you that question. Why enzyme is that selective? So enzyme is selective. An enzyme possesses a specific binding site. You already know it. This is called active site. And this substrate will bind. This is called substrate site of active site. You already know this. Substrate will bind to this site and it will form enzyme substrate complex. You already know this also. Like this enzyme, these are substrate, it will bind to this enzyme, this part. This is called substrate site or active site. And after binding to this site, it will form a reaction. For example, ligase. Ligase will bind to these two sites, there will be formation of bond. So there can be formation of bond and there can be breaking down reaction. You can see the formation of bond can be happen. So this is anabolic reaction. Remember, so reaction is of two types. Anabolic and catabolic. Anabolic, as I have already told you, it requires energy in first class. Remember that first class. It will require energy. If you don't remember, you can go on YouTube and you can actually revise that lecture. So this is anabolic. Joining is anabolic. Now catabolic reaction is breaking down reaction. In our body, there are two types of reaction. A catabolic reaction will release energy. Generally, it produces energy. And this energy is utilized by anabolic reaction. So our body, we grow because of which reaction? Both catabolic and anabolic reaction. Do you know this? Both catabolic and anabolic. Anabolic reaction will produce protein, lipid, carbohydrate that will make cell and cell will make body. And then catabolic reaction will provide energy. Ultimate source of energy is sun. So this is all, both this reaction are very important reaction for our body. But in extreme condition, in like when you don't take food, there will be pure catabolism happening inside our body. When you take too much food, there will be anabolism only and catabolism will be impeded. Both extreme condition are bad, not desired. So you should not always take food. There should be gap in between taking food so that your catabolism and anabolism will both be stimulated. So our body require both. So during prolonged, always if you keep eating, you will have always anabolism, and that type of pathologic anabolism. If you don't eat, you will have catabolism. So we require both. Now, so two model has been given. One is rigid model, so key and lock. So enzyme is a what? Lock, and substrate is a key. So key will fit to the lock. That is called key lock model. So it will give you a specificity or selectivity. Selectivity and specificity are related. Okay, if something is selected, then it will be specific to that. Now, what will happen? Second model is called flexible model. One is rigid, second is flexible. And this is actually accepted model. Flexible model is accepted model because it has been backed up by experimentation. Experimentation has proved that this, you can see one enzyme. One enzyme can change its shape here. This is glucokinase. When this glucose bind to this, actually hexokinase, this is hexokinase. When hexokinase, glucose, it binds glucose, so the molecule will change its structure. So this is a flexible model, is accepted model. So we will take it as accepted model. Now conformation change will happen in enzyme. So this is the induced feed model. This is key lock model, you can see here key lock model. So there is fixed key, lock is there and key will fit, substrate is key, will fit to this lock. But here it is not fixed. So this substrate will induce and will fit to this. So this model is accepted model. You can see here, this is not very equal to this, but when it comes near, so what will happen? The enzyme will change its structure, change its form to adapt to substrate. Here also you can see the enzyme will change its shape to adapt to substrate. So this is induced feed model is accepted. And this model will give you both selectivity and specificity. Selectivity and specificity. How this is how it selects, and it is very specific to one substrate, and it will specifically catalyze one reaction to that substrate. So specificity is more about reaction plus choosing plus reaction, and selectivity is choose. So if you place many substrate together, it will pick one particular substrate, not all substrate. This is called selectivity. Now enzyme concentration, as I have told you, enzyme concentration, so how does it affect? An enzyme catalyzes a reaction from this enzyme substrate complex. And that is why enzyme may be considered to take part in reaction. So this is how actually if you increase the enzyme concentration, so it will increase the rate of reaction. This is how it will be proportional reaction. So let's see, and we write enzyme as this enzyme concentration. So let's see this reaction. This is very important equation. This equation is called Michaelis-Menten equation. Just you memorize this equation. So V is equal to V. Okay, V is equal to V by what? Substrate Km. Just remember V is equal to V by Km. And you add substrate above and below. You add substrate above V into substrate, below Km plus substrate. Okay, you add below, and so what is V is equal to V max by Km plus substrate concentration and into S. Remember this very important equation. V max by Km plus S into S. So S is substrate concentration. This whole reaction is called, the equation is called Michaelis-Menten equation. And this equation actually determines the rate of reaction. Rate of reaction in enzyme is determined by this equation. And Km is constant, Michaelis-Menten constant. We will actually elaborate this reaction. We will see the application of this reaction in this actually graph. So this is C. This is the representation, graphical representation of this is pictorial graphical representation of this equation. V is equal to V max into substrate concentration, you can see, by Km plus V, Km plus substrate concentration. So this is the pictorial representation. What does it mean? When you increase velocity, so when you add substrate, so velocity will be increased up to certain point, and this velocity is called V max. And when after that, the velocity will not increase, the velocity will be constant. So this graph simply says that after that velocity will be constant. So we have already seen, and this is a hyperbolic curve. Now you can see here, from this graph you can conclude this Km is equal to substrate concentration at which V max. What does Km, definition of Km, Km means substrate concentration at which velocity is half V max. So this is Km. Km will be this substrate concentration. When you put one line here, it is half V max. And then when you put one line and drop like this, drop the line below, this substrate concentration is called Km. So this is Km. Now at low substrate concentration, you can see at low substrate concentration up to this, can you see very straight line? Straight line. And after certain concentration, you can see line can be, will be curved. So this is proportional. Here velocity is proportional to substrate concentration. You can see velocity is being proportional to substrate concentration. At high substrate, if you can see at high substrate, if substrate is very high, what is happening? Velocity is equal to V max. V max is the velocity at highest concentration. So you have to memorize these three factor about this graph. This graph is, this graph is graph of enzyme kinetics. So enzyme rate, speed of reaction increases this fashion. So speed of reaction increases to a certain point, that is called Vmax. After that, speed of reaction will not increase until you don't increase of enzyme concentration. If you increase enzyme concentration, then rate of reaction will increase. Okay. So this is called kinetics. So at fixed rate of at fixed concentration of enzyme, so this will be the curve. And you can, from this curve, you can derive three. Km is equal to half Vmax. And at here, this is true. And here, this is true. Now we will see through equation. See the equation. So when there is very high amount of what? When substrate concentration is half, equal, sorry, Km is equal to substrate concentration. Just see. So what will be the equation? Equation will be 2S. Because what is the definition of Km? Km is the concentration at which velocity half Vmax. How do we get this? When Km is equal to substrate concentration here, if you see, if Km, here Km is a substrate. So when Km equal to substrate concentration, so this substrate will be 2S. Now both this will cut, and what happens? So velocity will become half Vmax. So this is how we can derive the definition of Km. So Km is the value of substrate where velocity of reaction is half of the maximum velocity. You understood? So this is from equation you can derive this. Now let's derive the second part, this second equation. So what does this mean? At low substrate, velocity is equal to substrate, is proportional to substrate concentration. At low substrate concentration, you can see very low. If substrate concentration is very low, in comparison to Km, so it becomes negligible in front of Km. So what will happen is this equation will become like this. So V max is equal to by Km. K Km into substrate concentration. Now Km is also constant and Vmax is also constant. That is why V is equal to proportional to substrate concentration. At very low concentration of substrate, so velocity will be proportional to substrate. Now at very high substrate concentration, so at this place what will happen? Km will become negligible in comparison to substrate. So this negligible concentration, you can see negligible concentration, that is why what will happen? V will be become equal to Vmax. So because substrate will go and this substrate will go, this will become Vmax. So these two, three conclusion. Now we will do this question in next class so that you will remember these all things. So you go through these questions, we will do this question in next class and we will do a few more things about kinetics. Okay.